Now, controversy continues to swirl around the Paris Club loan refunds, following the concerns raised by the Nigerian Governors Forum. It is all about the decision by the Attorney General and the Minister of Justice, Abubakar Malami, to begin deducting millions of dollars from the accounts of 36 states to settle their indebtedness to consultants and private firms. Well, the chairman of the Nigerian Governors Forum and Ekiti State Governor, Kayode Fayemi, shared his thoughts on a Rise interview with our colleague, Charles Anyagolu.
It is not really in the character of the Governors Forum to discuss matters that are sub judice in the public arena. But the Attorney General has left us with very little option, because this is a matter that we have been discussing with him, with Mr. President, with the Chief of Staff, with the Honorable Minister of Finance, for the better part of the last 7-8 months. The Attorney General is my colleague in the cabinet of President Muhammadu Buhari, and I would like to think he's also somebody who occupies an office that I have tremendous respect for. It is the only ministerial office mentioned in the Nigerian Constitution, and he's the Attorney General of the Federation. This morning, he said on your program, your morning show, that he is the Attorney General of the federal government. I'm afraid that's wrong. He's the Attorney General of the Federation, and he should be defending parties, federal, state, as well as local governments, rather than defending consultants. And that's why I said it's unfortunate that we would even be put in this situation. But now let's go to brass tacks, Charles. There are four particular cases that concern us. Linus Nedu Nwoko versus the federal government and the Algon, a company called RIOC Nigerian Limited belonging to one Nicholas Ukachukwu. The third relates to a gentleman known as George Obo, who runs a company called Panic Alert. And the fourth, I believe, relates to a gentleman called Ted Isegohi, who used to be an official of Algon in the past. And I would like you to also recall that these are matters relating to the Paris Club refund as far back, Charles, as 2005. And they've tried to get this money from the Obasanjo administration. They failed. They tried it with the Yar'Adua administration. They failed. They tried it with the Jonathan administration. They failed. They have now resorted to taking advantage of the decency and the generosity of spirit of President Muhammadu Buhari to try and fleece the Nigerian people of these resources. And it is not 418, actually, Charles, it is $419 million. And that may ring some bell in many places. But coming back to a number of issues that the Attorney General highlighted in his remarks this morning on your program. One, he said he had an order of mandamus asking him to pursue this money. There is no order of mandamus anywhere, and I challenge the Attorney General to produce one if he has one. Two, he says that there is a consent judgment by the Nigerian Governors Forum as well as Algon, confirming that these monies are owed to these people, and that we consented that we will pay. Of course, I wasn't the chairman of the Nigerian Governors Forum in the period referred to, and indeed the consent judgment that he referred to did not mention any amount in any of them. Take, for example, the one relating to Mr. George Obo, the Panic Alert. This was something that purportedly was given to him to do, Charles, by the faction of the Nigerian Governors Forum that is not even recognized. And I happen to have been a governor in the era of 1619 controversy. So there was no Jonah Jang administration of the Nigerian Governors Forum. Rotimi Amaechi was the official, authentic chairman of the Nigerian governors at that time. And what was claimed relates to a review of a judgment for which he allegedly was offered $7 million. Charles, you know quite a few people. You and I lived in the UK. Not even Clifford Chance, not Baker and McKenzie, not Linklaters. These are the top law firms in the world that will charge $7 million for a two-page letter purportedly given to some faction of the Governors Forum on the back of the review of a judgment. It does not happen anywhere in the world. It does not even appeal to common sense at all. And this is why it befuddles the mind that the Attorney General of the Federation is pushing so vehemently on the side of people whose primary intent is to fleece the Nigerian people. That's one. Even the EFCC that reviewed all of these matters actually accused the Federal Ministry of Justice of lack of diligent prosecution of these matters. These matters were not appealed by the Federal Ministry of Justice. Admittedly, not under Abubakar Malami at the time. But what is happening now is just a continuation of this sleight of hand. And that is what the governors are challenging.
Right. A lot to unpack here.
Such an awful lot, but I'm going to start with that $419 million. I mean, an unfortunate figure, really, that actually underscores what we're talking about here. The allegation here is that there's a shakedown underway, and we are the patsies, the Nigerian public, really. Mm. And this brings that argument once again about Section 150 of the Constitution. The question has been asked all too often, exactly whose side is the Attorney General on? Mm. And that argument about that constitutional amendment, or we hope to see one at some point, is about splitting Minister of Justice and Attorney General, because Minister of Justice is a cabinet position, so whose side is he on, the people or the cabinet or the party? But now we're looking at even another dimension. Whose side is the Attorney General on, the consultants or Nigeria? Really, it's that simple, because the allegations that were made, obviously yesterday we had Mr. Bello Barkindo speaking on this issue. We now have the NGF chairman. We heard from him, Governor Fayemi, and the allegations that have been made are really quite shocking and hard to justify. That point that he raised about $7 million for 5 minutes' work, how can that be justified? How is it possible to justify it? And that question of the unseemly haste and the fact that the matter is still sub judice, it's all just... It's indicative of something really sinister, and I don't want to say more because it is sub judice, but it's important, I feel, that we're hearing from both sides and the public can make up their minds on this issue. The Attorney General has spoken out, the NGF has spoken out, and I think we can all do the math.
Mm. Yes, with due respect, I think that, yes, the last point you made, it's a very important point, that, you know, both sides have been heard in the court of public opinion. Yesterday, we spoke with the Attorney General. We spoke also with Bello Barkindo, speaking on behalf of the other side in the dispute. Now, I guess that in the court of public opinion, people will form an opinion one way or the other, but we're not in a position to adjudicate on the matter, since the matter is already before a court of competent jurisdiction. As for Section 150, yes, many Nigerians talk about it, that the position of the Attorney General of the Federation should not be mixed with politics. And that oftentimes we have these attorneys general at the federal level who behave as if they are politicians. They mix politics with their work as the chief law officer of the Federation. But in this particular instance, I consider that a separate argument. The states, yes, do they have the right to insist on their rights or to push the envelope in whatever direction they want? Yes. So the states and the AG Federation, their matter can be determined by the courts. But the question is, how long will that last? What happens in terms of implications for the deployment of funds to the states? I know that the states have also tried to seek an injunction, but we're dealing with a federal government that oftentimes ignores injunctions or rulings from the courts. So that's the other side of it. And that's why I think It's important to ask whether at this point there's another way in which the matter can be resolved. The chairman of the Governors Forum is saying that they've been on this matter for quite a while. They've had meetings with the chief of staff, they've had meetings with the president of Nigeria. But some way or the other, it is the people of Nigeria, the people in those states that will be affected, because the states are now saying they will not collect any allocation from the Federation account that shows any sign of any deduction with regard to these four consultants properly identified by Dr. Kaode Fayemi. Okay, the other leg of it is that he's saying that in the consent judgment that the Attorney General of the Federation was referring to, that no amount was specified. In other words, part of the challenge is about what they consider the opaqueness of the amount, the $418 million or the $419 million, that he was talking about. Okay, wasn't there any negotiation? And who engaged in the negotiation? What exactly was agreed upon? I guess these are some of the details that the court will be looking at. But I think that it looks really untidy that this matter has been going on forever and ever. Yesterday, Bello Bakinde said, some of the governors who signed up to whatever agreement were no longer in the office. And Dr. Fayemi himself pointed out that, well, at the time whatever agreement was signed, he was not, man in the saddle as chairman of the Governors Forum. Now, he raised a point about where the loyalty of the Attorney General of the Federation lies. Does it lie with private consultants who are throwing up figures, whether those figures were negotiated or not? Or does it lie with the Federation itself, which will involve the interest of the states? Well, that will be another matter that will have to be determined. You know, what exactly was agreed upon? All those fine details, we are not in a position at the court of public opinion, because we don't have the material evidence before us for us to be able to assess. But we want to hope that the case will be handled expeditiously because of the implications for public financing and financing, particularly at the state level, and the overall collateral effect that all of this may have with state performance and the people of Nigeria. But if we think we've seen the end of the matter in terms of, relationship between the federal government and the subnationals, this is not likely to be the end. But it's good. Everything should be tested in the court of law, because that's the best place to resolve disputes, either between states and the federal government, or among states, or between individuals or organizations and the Nigerian state itself.
So I want to quote a certain Tunde Abiola that says, Nigeria is like a movie. We are watching this now.
It's really interesting. But I'll go back to the issue of the Attorney General, if I may.
Okay.
The general issue is always about splitting Minister of Justice and Attorney General of the Federation. But, like I said, clearly, this is a different dimension now with regards to whose side the Attorney General is actually on.
Yeah.
That is the bottom line.
I'll go back to Nigeria as a movie, all right? That's all on New Zealand. We'll take a short break now. When we return, we'll have Ruth Zudiri back and Wilson to give us updates on global and Africa business news. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
Welcome back to Morning Show here on Arise News. Our dependable Ruth Zudiri is here to give us an African business update.
Yes.
Over to you.
Good morning, Tunde. Good morning, Rufai. Good morning, Doctor. We kick off with FCMB. There was a... they've denied a viral tweet that was put out yesterday saying that they have been targeting accounts owned by 18 to 30-year-olds for money laundering. In fact, you can take a look at the tweet right now. It's from a verified account, which was, quite troubling. So it's a tweet call from, I think it's Ninja PR. Yeah, there it is. So it says, FCMB has put out an alert on accounts held by people between the ages of 18 to 30, asking staff to be on the lookout for money launderers and other criminal activities. I mean, if you're targeting, you can imagine the impact of this. So we reached out to them. And they put out this statement, just debunking it, saying that, they have not placed an alert on account holders in between ages 18 and 30. They value relationships with young Nigerians and will never directly or indirectly profile them as fraud suspects. In assuring adherence to anti-money laundering and know your customer rules of Nigeria, they are required to maintain processes that are generic and do not target any group with respect to age range. Now, what's been happening over the last few days is that people have been going on social media to share screenshots of notifications and warnings from different financial institutions to stop using their accounts for trading cryptocurrencies. As you know, the Central Bank of Nigeria placed an order with banks that they should not facilitate the processing of buying or selling of cryptocurrencies. Now, some people have gone ahead and done it. And so what's been happening now is that some accounts are being closed. I think it wasn't even just FCMB that was mentioned. Kuda Bank, I think, put out a statement yesterday or the day before saying that, look, you know, we have to follow the guidelines of the Central Bank. So this is clearly false, because with all the other notifications that have been shown up online, they've been supported with a screenshot of a letter or so coming from the bank. So there was nothing here. It was just a tweet. And, I mean, you need to have seen the replies. So it was, you know, I think it was important for them to quickly get ahead of this as fast as possible. So I guess the narrative has been there's some kind of attack on youth because of this whole, you know, cryptocurrency thing. But, you know, they're the regulators, the financial regulator. It's not just them that's doing this. You know, China's doing the same thing. They said do not use bank accounts to facilitate these transactions, and if you do, your account will be closed, you know. So anyway, FCMB has just, you know, made it clear that they are not targeting youth accounts. From FCMB, we go to UBA from tier 2 to tier 1. UBA's bond, Eurobond, $300 million Eurobond, has been oversubscribed. So the order book, that is, if every one of us here was to place an order, you know, for the bond, it would go into an order book. The order book was to the tune of about $520 million. So that's about 1.6, 1.7 times what they were requesting. And that's, you know, oversubscription is just referring to the demand for the debts that they're putting out there. And it's not just UBA, Fidelity Bank, Access Bank before them. If you want to go to a country level, Nigeria, Egypt, a number of, you know, corporate entities and sovereign governments have been tapping the capital markets for Eurobonds because, you know, interest rates are pretty low. So, you know, it's, again, UBA, Pan-African Bank, large presence across the continent, low non-performing, as far as non-performing loans are concerned, they are right on, well underneath the threshold, well-capitalized bank. You all had Tony Elumelu here on an exclusive interview not too long ago, so that this is no surprise that that's been oversubscribed. From Nigeria, we move on to Kenya. This is Dr. Patrick Ndoroje, who says that he was at a fintech event. It was virtual, and he said that Kenya is now looking to explore a digital shilling, essentially a central bank digital currency, and they're looking to explore it for the purpose of cross-border payments to reduce costs and so on and so forth. Pretty much the same reasons why, you know, Nigeria launched her own digital naira. And then beyond that, still in Kenya, Kenya Airways, Rufai, I know you've talked about this before. They are seeking $250 million bailouts from the government. I mean, the government already owns 48-49% of, that's the Kenyan government, owns 48-49% of Kenya Airways already. And they have said they will try to assist the airline in, you know, in reducing some of its liabilities. But this is, of course, due to what COVID has done with respect to grounding their flights. They are back in the air, but they're looking at probably not getting up to 65-70% of pre-pandemic capacity until 2022, maybe more than that in 2023. But the thing about this, Kenya Airways was making losses before COVID. Yeah. So, you know, yeah. Even if they get this bailout, who's to say that those losses would not continue? And that's our update.
Not run effectively, Kenya Airways, I should say, was in dire straits even before COVID.
Right.
I mean, this brings to the question again, government owning airlines, you know, how viable is that? There's a conversation on that. Vis-a-vis in a world where it's largely dominated by low-budget airlines and the likes and, you know, market viability. So, I mean, I don't see anything extra that KNA was going to do. But I'm really excited that KNA is getting on board this digital currency. And I argue that it's really long overdue.
Right.
Because, you see, I'm shocked that we're still spending paper money now.
I know, right?
Yeah.
When you think about it, the actual,
you know, the paper money started in the Ming Dynasty in China.
Right.
And that's over 500-600 years ago, and we've not iterated money since then, and we're still spending paper money like from the Ming Dynasty.
It's a
good point.
I don't know.
Okay, on FCMB, I think that the clarification is very useful. You recall that when the Central Bank of Nigeria came up with a number of policies about fintech, about cryptocurrency, the big concern at the time was that in this particular space where many young Nigerians were playing and seemed to be doing very well, that part of the attempt was to frustrate this youth bulge, this youth energy that you have in Nigeria. And in that FCMB statement, you know, somebody put out a tweet saying the bank is targeting persons between 18 and 30. Of course, that's a big, you know, would be a big dent on their brand if it were to be true. So the prompt response from the bank is very useful. But the question that I will ask you is that, you know, is this a case of demarketing? Because now that the Nigerian banks even have, you know, telecoms, you know, coming into that space, there's so much competition within that the banking space and the telecom space. Maybe, you know, the bank should go a step further and investigate, you know, digital footprint. Mm-hmm. You can always track these things down. And there may be consequential steps that they can take with regard to this. As for Kenya, well, Kenya will probably become the second country in Africa that will introduce a central bank digital currency after Nigeria. Nigeria seems to be doing well, or seems to be showing some prospect, because within a matter of days, over 400,000 wallets have been taken up by private persons, over 100,000 wallets by business concerns. Okay, there was an initial glitch, which was promptly corrected by the Central Bank of Nigeria. But the question I keep asking is that, okay, maybe if Kenya also goes into that space, we can use that to measure what Nigeria is doing, you know, and I don't mean that in an unpatriotic manner. But the big concern is that if you look at the big countries of the world, they seem to be very skeptical about, you know, this digital currency. The U.S. is not moving fast with it. Russia says it's studying it. China is experimenting with it in Shenzhen, in Beijing, and Guangzhou, you know. So, but African countries seem to be showing, you know, a lot of interest. But of course, the whole point is about the future of money and the evolution of money and what works best for the economy and for transactions. Kenya Airways has been losing money since 2014.
Yes.
It's an unprofitable business. In 2017, the Kenyan government, you know, did a debt swap deal with Kenya Airways and took over about 19.1% of it, and it's grown. The equity has grown. They just converted the debt into equity. Now, the Kenyan government has now promised to further bail out both Kenya Airways and Kenya Energy in 2022. And it's on the basis of that that Kenya Airways is now saying, no, the money that is being offered is not enough. Add more to it. But the truth of the matter is that since COVID, since the pandemic, the aviation sector has been the most impacted, if I may say so, because of the travel tourism industry. And okay, they have their own issues in Kenya. But what is the situation here in Nigeria? We heard a lot of stories about the bailout of the aviation sector. Persons, big players in the aviation sector came onto this television to say, look, not enough was being done for them, and that in fact not enough progress was being made. I would like to see you know, what happens in our own aviation sector here in Nigeria, so that I don't travel to a part of the country and I'll be stranded and nobody will offer me any explanations, and I'll have to use my phone to start calling influential people to get me out, you know, of a desperate situation. That may be my example. Some people, in fact, these days when they go to Nigeria Airport, they go with a mat or a small mattress in their bag so that they can sleep there. So how do we re-engineer the aviation sector here also, so that we don't keep worrying about the global picture? Let it start here. The railways are not working. The roads are not safe. Even common flight from Lagos to anywhere in Nigeria, I'll be having palpitations to move from one place to the other.
I saw OG's video yesterday, the train that was stopped like a downfall bus.
So embarrassing. Yeah. Well, we've run out of time, but I just wanted to talk about the FCMB story. And yes, it's very important that they were swift to respond, because it is demarketing, really. We still have all kinds of wounds from NSARS, and that whole idea was about youth being profiled by police officers. So it's a crime in this country to be young, and next thing you get a tweet saying this bank is targeting people. That's the worst thing you can actually do to attack a business. So they were right to really quickly refute that. Well, thank you so much, Reuters.
Thank you. Thank you.
Moving on now to more business updates. Michael Wilson joins us from London. Good morning, Mr. Wilson.
Good morning. Yes, so shares basically rising very slightly in Asia Pacific. The Hang Seng gained about a quarter of a percent. The others are up very slightly. It was all about that big shopping day, Singles Day yesterday. JD.com soaring nearly 5%, setting records there. Alibaba, again, setting records, but down about 1.4%. And meanwhile, Hong Kong listed shares of the Chinese chipmaker Semiconductor Manufacturing International, SMI, dropped 5% after there's been a bit of a reshuffle on the board. They're saying it's nothing, not to do with misconduct. They're just having a reshuffle and it won't affect anything. We'll see. The Hang Seng Tech Index gained about 1%. Toshiba, this is interesting, a giant company. It's not going to go private. It's going to split into three parts. It's had a very, very checkered history, as you know, and we've often reported on this programme. That's what is happening. The shares did rise when it got an offer from CBC Capital in London, but that fell back. Shareholders unhappy, so they're going to split it into three, and they're not going to take it private. So as I was saying then, Alibaba, JD.com, smashed singles day record, $139 billion worth of sales across their platforms, setting a new record. Singles day slightly more muted though, as Chinese technology companies continue to face scrutiny from the government there, and of course the president pressing for this thing called common prosperity. However, that sort of shock announcement between China and the United States yesterday on the penultimate day of COP26 has sparked some cautious optimism. It was a joint declaration, if you remember, at the climate change summit in Glasgow. It covers a number of issues, including cutting carbon dioxide and methane emissions. The countries said they're going to try to work towards that Paris total of between 2 and 1.5% increase in degrees centigrade. And it expressed an intention to start a working group which will meet regularly to talk about the concerns that debate and that conference has been all about. And speaking of which, Joe Biden and Xi Jinping are to address Asia Pacific leaders on trade and COVID recovery. We think it's going to be later today. I only say think because these things often get changed, but both of them are going to talk to APEC, which is the Asia Pacific Economic Cooperation Committee meeting this week, both of them warning that they don't want this to slip into a cold war. Biden is expected to address this and also add some takeaways from the COVID-19 summit. So as far as the United States is concerned, a bit of a recap there. Stock futures up very, very slightly. Wall Street coming out of those shock inflation figures, which we got on Wednesday. It's taken a couple of days for that actually to sink in. The major indexes back on track to snap a five-week winning streak, but are still within striking distance of setting new records. That's what the market's saying right now. This is the end of the week. Now, to the EU and a fourth wave of COVID. This is Germany was once a real poster child of how to deal with the pandemic, but apparently it's now recording close to 50,000 new COVID cases a day. The country's early pandemic response was quite quick. That slowed down. A lot of scepticism amongst its population. Only 67.3% of the population is fully vaccinated, and this is the fourth day in the round. Now, lawmakers can do what they like about this. They can act in separate states. They can impose lockdowns if they want to. Overall, Germany does not want to impose a further lockdown nationally, but you never know. Coming back to the UK, Johnson Matthey, it's abandoned its electric car battery plans. It was going to go for the big, extremely large market, because when it happens is different for electric cars, but it's said that its rivals are so far ahead, it's not really worth doing. And finally on this week, oil prices moving slightly lower, dollar rising, and secondly, more and more thoughts that the supply chain, as far as oil is concerned, and supply shortages will ease early next year. That is the global view this morning.
Two things, Michael. Boris Johnson is under fire. He earned about £4 million on the side from being an MP. He didn't declare that. What is happening? This hypocrisy is a gift that keeps giving. And Germany, the second, about the largest economy in Europe, is looking for a new chief of the Bundesbank. What should they be looking out for as regards all of this economic uncertainties going on?
Well, as I say, I'm not a political expert. All I can say is that this is price that politicians have to pay if they mix business with their work. I am personally not against MPs having second jobs. And the reason being, I'm not talking about Boris Johnson, I'm talking about MPs having second jobs, because I think it's important to have people from lower pay sectors actually in government so that we get a slice of real life. Now, living in London is very expensive. Travelling to London is very expensive. Until Westminster actually devolves into the different parts of the UK, I don't have a problem about MPs having second jobs. Many of them are surgeons, many of them are nurses, many of them are medical practitioners, and so on. I think that's perfectly fine. I think when it gets to corruption, that's a whole other story. That is something which is gradually coming out of this. I expect the Augean stables, as Keir Starmer put it earlier in the week, to be swept with a very powerful hose. Where that will end, I do not know. As far as the Bundesbank is concerned, I always thought the Bundesbank, given that we have now the European Central Bank, is nominally in charge, I always think that the Bundesbank is in charge. It was always thus. Germany does the money, France does the weapons. That's what the EU was all about, and I think it's still there. That's why I brought to your attention the fact that Germany may be going through a fourth wave of COVID, which we hope, I really hope it does not affect their economic recovery, but you never know. That's why that's important. So president of the Bundesbank's one thing. I think the general health of the German economy is something else, again, which they appear to have little control over at the moment.
Well, quickly, Michael, you talk about the Singles Day, the largest online retail sale introduced by Alibaba 11 years ago. And then we had just this week that online sale by Alibaba and JD. We did very well. But I found something curious there. This was the lowest sales outcome that they have had since 2009 in real terms. And we had Alibaba saying that, well, this year the emphasis is on corporate social responsibility. Is that an indication of fear arising from, China clamping down on tech giants in that country? I say that because one newspaper, Securities Daily, which is a state-backed, newspaper, did an editorial in which it was condemning the Singles Day. They called it a turnover celebration, a worship of turnover. Mom and pop, events that do not achieve much, that promote spam tests, that, just places unnecessary emphasis on profit. And that newspaper, concluded, Securities Daily is called, that this is not in line with the new vision of China. So what is the new vision of China? China pretends today to be a capitalist country. Tomorrow, he's saying something else. And then finally, in England, the Office of National Statistics, the growth figures between July and September September 2021, 1.3% growth, lower than the 1.5% expected by the Treasury also. And then here comes Rishi Sunak saying, oh, this is very good. It's a confirmation of what the government has been doing. Whereas businesses are saying that, look, England, the United Kingdom should even be more worried about these growth figures because it means spending may have gone up, but the recovery process is likely to go far into the future and that there is an urgent need to deal with the headwinds with regard to inflation and other rates.
Oh, okay. Right. China is an enigma, as we know. Capitalist on the outside, communist within the middle. I have no idea what the message about communities actually means. Singles Day, the people voted with their online shopping, didn't they? I mean, if China wants to change that wave, well, good luck to them. Unfortunately, that's the way it is. I feel as though it happened. Reports are, and I can only go on reports, that things were slightly muted because of the way in which China is cracking down on high-tech companies. But generally speaking, that will succeed. As far as the growth figures are concerned, which we covered yesterday, yes, I think the only silver lining in this is that it may just put off the necessity for an interest rate rise, because nobody would be doing that if the economy is going weaker as it is at the moment. So we came quickly out of the pandemic and now things are levelling off. This is a similar pattern to most developed economies right now. It's just the way it is. And the economy is 2% smaller than it was before we went into the pandemic. Much, much better result than a lot of people feared as we were going into the pandemic. So the guessing game is still going on. If I were a central banker, I would still be hedging my bets, quite honestly, about interest rate rises and maybe not doing anything till the end of next year. I expected something on Thursday last. It didn't happen. I, like most people, was completely wrong about that. So I could be wrong about this. All I'm saying is that I feel as though the bank is taking a very, very careful, if rather contradictory route, and I'm not excusing any members of the Monetary Policy Committee. They do, they say, but they're like, the general public has no control over them. But if it's putting off a sharp interest rate rise, I think that's probably quite a good idea. That would be the only silver lining from all this. We're still feeling our way forward in the fog of uncertainty.
Well, thank you, Mr. Wilson.